On September 18th of this year, Frankie and I flew from San Francisco via Dallas to Dublin for a two-week trip. We were to spend 3 days in Dublin and then rent a car and go in a clockwise direction from Southeast Ireland and County Tullow over to Kerry in the southwest and up the western coast, all the way up to Galway and Connemara. Our hotel was a small, charming boutique hotel called the Killarney. It was in southern Dublin, just below St. Stephen's Green and the National Concert Hall. Paid homage to Ireland's famous writers and poets, and each of its rooms was named after one of them. Our first room was the James Joyce room, and when we returned at the end of the trip, we were given the Oscar Wilde room. Unfortunately, there were no elevators, so all our luggage had to be schlepped up by hand. All the town names and the street names in Ireland were generally named both in English and in Irish Gaelic. About 2 blocks from our hotel, we discovered the second oldest pub in Ireland, called the Bleeding Horse, which went back to the mid-1600s. No one is certain why it got the name of Bleeding Horse, but we had a few meals there, which were very good, as was most of the food in Ireland. And of course, I had my first Guinness. About midway between the hotel, north to the River Liffey, was St. Stephen's Green, a beautiful city park. Also the home of some fighting during the Battle of Dublin back in the 1920s. Now it was just a charming place in the middle of the city to watch life go by, as well as street artists. There was lots of bird life in Ireland. I was unfamiliar with this type of gull. The city is bisected by the River Liffey. On the north banks is the famous famine sculpture. evoking memories of their 1846 to 1848 Irish famine, in which over 1 million people died when the potato crop failed, and more than 1.5 million emigrated to North America. This was all under British rule. Just south of the River Liffey is the famous Trinity College, which is sort of the Harvard of Ireland. It's also the home of the famous Book of Kells. Of Kells go back to 800 AD, and many old books are housed in the Trinity College Library. Unfortunately, most of the old books were removed for restoration, so all we saw were empty shelves. Yet it was still an imposing sight, with all the high shelves of books that could only be reached by high ladders. And it also contained the Boru harp, which is the national symbol of Ireland, also portrayed on the Guinness beer glass. Here is the famous Dublin Castle, which was the headquarters for the occupying British forces going back 700 years. And this is a famous Irish emigrant ship during the potato famine, owned by a benevolent Irish doctor who assured that the boat was not overcrowded. People had plenty of fresh air and nutritious food, in contrast to many of the other Irish emigrant ships. I was fascinated by the doors of Dublin. I heard a story that they were painted different colors by the wives of Dubliners, so when their drunken husband meandered back from the closing pubs, they would be able to find the correct door by the color of it. My preferred color was yellow. I don't know what yours would be. Green is nice too. Grafton Street is a famous shopping street. It's closed to cars, a lot of high-end shops, and young people's fashion shops, which are always amusing to watch. But it was also famous in 1920 for street fighting between the IRA forces and British forces during the Battle of Dublin, 1920. And of course, in Dublin, there are lots of bookshelves. just north of St. Stephen's Square, there are lots of embassies. A lot of the buildings display Georgian architecture dating back to earlier British rule. We saw very little graffiti, nor did we see much homelessness. So I was surprised a couple months after we left when they had the Dublin riots November 24th after a Moroccan Irish immigrant stabbed three people. I was not aware of the unrest that existed in Ireland, especially among disillusioned young people. On our fourth day in Ireland, we rented a car. And of course, Irish drive on the left-hand side of the road, just like they do in the UK. Our first night we spent down in southeastern Ireland, in County Tullow, and we had lunch at a famous castle called Duckett's Grove. I call this a fake castle, because it was built in the 19th century by a wealthy family, rather than a medieval castle built by a duke or an earl. Nevertheless, it was a pretty castle and had beautiful grounds. And here's a very famous American couple. I'm not sure what they're famous for. We stayed at Dunrovin Guest House. Rather difficult to find in the rural countryside. Rural homes in Ireland don't have street numbers like they do in the United States. And often, cell phone reception was non-existent, and therefore we couldn't use our phone GPS. The owner, Sarah, did tell us to look for three donkeys. Unfortunately, there were no villages or towns nearby, and we had to do some long drives to get food. Irish pubs tend to be very charming, and they always serve good food. There are many Irish back roads that are one lane wide, and a challenge to drive them, especially around blind corners and with lots of farm equipment and tractors. But that's a fact of driving in Ireland. This is the small village of Shalala. Frankie had visited when she did her walk through Ireland a couple years ago. It's famous for the making of Shalala, going back hundreds of years. Shalala is a weapon crafted from the blackthorn tree and was used in duels or for defense. Unfortunately, the Shalala manufacturing place was closed. Now these are sold to tourists as hiking sticks. The next day, we continued our tour through the back roads of Ireland to southwest Ireland, to County Kerry. Killarney is a delightful medium-sized town. Here you can see how the Irish commonly will paint their storefronts different colors, just like they do in Portugal. Killarney is next to the famous Killarney National Park and also is the stepping point to tours of the famous Ring of Kerry, the Dingle Peninsula, and then to the island of Skellig Michael. Rather than drive the Ring of Kerry tour, which involved narrow roads and lots of tour buses, we decided to take a day tour. This is our apartment, which we found charming, called Copper Kettle. It was about a block from the main street, called College Street, with lots of pubs and restaurants. Ring of Kerry is a famous circle that can be done in one day. We chose to take a tour bus. The best way to drive this is if you have a car, is to do it counterclockwise, as the tour buses do. You don't want to do it clockwise because if you run into a tour bus, it could be difficult. And here's a bog village representing many rural Irish villages in the 19th century. After the famine, many of these villages were abandoned, and all throughout the country, especially in the west, you can see abandoned stone cottages. Incredibly, because of the poverty of Ireland, many families lived with anywhere from 6 to 12 people in a one-room cottage such as this. They were heated by peat fires. And in some cottages, they even had animals. The Ring of Kerry has many beautiful views of the Atlantic Ocean. The population of Ireland plummeted during the potato famine from more than 5 million down to about 2 million, and even today is still below the pre-famine population. Charlie Chapman had a summer home here, Waterville. This is where you catch the ferry to Skellig Michael.
And three of my uncles and my grandparents are buried there.
Oh.
Here, do you see the houses underneath it? One of these houses looks like it had a garage on the side.
We enjoyed a demonstration by this gentleman and his prize-winning sheepdog.
Yes.
And here's the backup quarterback. we ran into Storm Agnes, which was the first major storm hitting the European continent. We drove up to Doolin in County Clare in high winds and heavy rains. Doolin is a small village of about 300, famous for its beautiful and colorful Main Street, but also as a center of traditional Irish music. Every year there are get-togethers from Irish musicians from all over Ireland who come to Doolin and play in the pubs. We stayed at another charming B&B out in the country. Just south of Doolin are the famous cliffs of Moher, probably the most famous representation of Ireland apart from the Giant's Causeway, which is actually in Northern Ireland. And just north of Doolin is the famous Burren, which we'll show in just a few minutes. It has been occupied since prehistoric times. The geology of the Burren continues onto the Aran Islands, which are just west of here, and which we will be visiting in a few days. Bally Vaughan. Whenever you see a town with the name Bally in front of it, that's Old Irish for village. And we had lunch at pretty little town of Kinvara. With the seals and armor light and the wind of heavenly night, aching drum, is not drowly in the right, aching drum. Did ye hear o' Sunderland, aching drum, did ye hear o' Sunderland, aching drum? That man of Fife command, who has sworn to clear the land, he has vanished from our strand, aching drum, all the eel has stained the sand, aching drum. Donald's run and run and run, aching drum, aching drum. That was a very good lunch. Donald's run and run, aching drum. But the chief cannot be found, and the Dutchmen they are drowned, and King Jamie he is drowned, aching drum, but the dogs will get us down, aching drum. We have had a wake galore. The Cliffs of Moher are iconic image of Ireland. They've been in numerous films and movies. I couldn't fly my drone because it was too windy and too rainy, so I borrowed some drone images from Google. You can see how dramatic cliffs are. Unfortunately, we didn't have sunshine. We had blustery winds and rain. This is a must stop for anyone visiting Ireland. Unlike America, there are no protective fences. You are on your own and expected to use good judgment. After spending the night in Doolin, we drove up to Galway and spent three nights up there. We took a day tour to the famous Aran Islands. If you saw the movie Banshees of Inisherin with Colin Farrell and Brendan Gleeson, they were filmed on Inismore, the largest of the three islands. And this is where our ferry is taking us. The islands are a continuation of the Burren limestone and hard rock. Aran Islands are famous for their extensive stone walls. The poor soil has been replenished and built up throughout the centuries by bringing in seaweed and sand. Apart from fishing, potato growing was the most common endeavor here. Here you can see all the stone walls, more beautiful and more intricate than even in New England. Notice also there are no trees. The island has several ring forts, which are prehistoric forts built to protect the inhabitants against marauders. This is the famous ring fort, Dunangus. And again, you can see the geological features of the Burren, which continue here. The fort is built on a 400-foot cliff. It's surrounded by cliffs. And since there was no port up until the last 50 years, fishermen had to lower their boats down the cliffs to get to the water. And here you can see the intricate stonework. This, of course, is all drywall. here are some very good drone views of the fort. The Aran Islands are famous for their knitwear. As shown here in this shop in Kilronan. And here is only one of two pubs on the island. And this is the waterfront where the ferry docks. The Aran Islands were very poor. Even today, when people reach high school age, they board in Galway and go to school there. Very few of them return. The islanders receive heavy government subsidies, which has made their life much more tolerable. And of course, as in many parts of Western Ireland, they use peat to heat their house. We spent 3 nights in Galway in an area called Salt Hill. Incredibly, people go swimming in this cold water. Galway is the third largest city in Ireland and considered by many to be the prettiest. It's a university town, so in the center on a Friday night, there are lots of young people, lots of restaurants and pubs.
Thank you. is a her and can the my hustle is couple is thought of on your mellow while a combined of her margin the earth. Couple is hustle is thought of come wide. I cannot you mock near water my vows, I cannot you pock below my hole. My comb is a chunk, my square no matter, I can my hand or a nail of her name. This couple is thought of on. Hope my no while look on my heart, my genie. Couple is also the start of gone wild.